word fight is a complicated word, but I think it's very versatile and can have a lot of meanings to different people depending on, you know, what you've been through in life. I've always been an athlete. Growing up, I played softball. I played at a very high level, and I was, you know, looking to go to college and go that route. I had big dreams to become a criminal psychologist and, you know, go that route, go Ivy League.
I do recall the moment when Kay became interested in martial arts.
She was watching the Ronda Rousey fight, and after the fight, she said, "I want to fight."
When I kind of dropped everything just for fighting, of course, some people were a little skeptical in my family, but at the end of the day, they knew that if I had that kind of passion for it, I could be successful in it.
It was kind of a shock being that she was at that time 16, but it was something that she was really determined to do.
For me, fighting has more meaning behind it. It's an individual sport. Of course, you have a team behind you and everything, but at the end of the day, you're the only one who's going in there. And I feel like it's the purest form of competition there is. When I was 16, my parents got into a huge fight. It resulted in my father leaving. I decided to go with him. When we split, we didn't have anywhere to go. We were homeless. We lived out of my dad's truck. And then that's when the sexual assault and rape started. I was dealing with all of this early on in my professional MMA career, and no one really knew about it, and I didn't really talk about it too much.
Kay's upbringing in regards to her father, I would describe it as very controlling. I knew her for about 4 or 5 years, but it wasn't until a few years after that I got to know her on a personal level. She had every aspect of her life controlled by him. Her social media was controlled by him, what she could and couldn't post. Financially, he controlled everything in there.
I was just in a very negative and toxic situation when it came to my father. So I didn't really have any relationship with my mom and my sisters. And if it was very strained. But I was basically cut off or told not to really speak to them.
I met her when she was about 16 years old. We bonded because we kind of had similar struggles. I think we do have a lot in common with just the way we train and just the way we handle things.
Being a child or a young teenager, 15, 16, 17, you don't really know much about the world, so you only know what you've seen, and her father didn't really let her see much except what he wanted her to see. So it was easy to not know really how to get out of a situation like that.
For me, it was hard to experience any emotions at the time. When you go through such difficult traumas, your brain kind of learns how to survive. And one of the ways it learns how to survive is not really feeling any emotions. You know, for me, I kind of pushed everything down and didn't really let it affect me, especially because fighting is such a mental game, you know, and I needed to stay sharp for that. So for me, I kind of just put everything I was feeling in my personal life on the back burner just to kind of stay strong for my career and put that in front.
She didn't get as close to her teammates because she was just in and out, no nonsense. Her dad just kept it all business.
For those few years when my dad really had his hold, I really didn't build any relationships inside the gym. I would kind of just go in the gym, put my head down and work and get out.
She really wasn't even allowed to have friends as much as I saw at the gym. You know, it was kind of in the door when practice started and out the door when practice ended. So no socializing. Just very controlling in most aspects.
Trying to explain to someone the situation and being like, oh, but you're an adult, like, it's a lot more complicated than that. My form of escape was training, though I definitely overdid it when it came to my training and overdid it as using training as a therapy. It was definitely a way of me trying to, like, escape my reality.
I met Kay, she was 17 years old. And I met her at a jiu-jitsu gym we're both training at. Man, she's probably like textbook definition, everything that you want in an athlete as a coach. Like, she'll listen to every word you say. She'll ask all the right questions.
Nice, stand up tall, catch with the hips. There we go.
I had like 3 or 4 amateur boxing matches, and then the one amateur MMA fight, a bunch of grappling tournaments, and I just jumped right in and I was like, I want to get this started.
It was kind of cool to watch because I would see her during the transition. She would go from competing in an ADCC to going to a boxing showcase, then all leading up to an Invicta fight.
Going to amateur to pro so quick, it just goes to show how hard she was working.
I made my amateur debut, I was 18, and by December, I was making my pro debut with Invicta.
Her go-getter mentality and her perseverance and her toughness just helped her do that, I think.
For me, making my pro debut on such an amazing platform was such a big deal to me.
A young athlete like that, who loves the sport so much, who was inspired by a Ronda Rousey, to be at that level in the sport at such a young age, I think is huge. I think that's life-changing for her.
I definitely remember that fight. I remember everything vividly. I was not nervous. I had no fear.
There it is.
The fight was really short. It went exactly how I wanted, and I was on top of the world after. I would say my second pro fight was like the biggest eye-opener for me. I, you know, was kind of this cocky, arrogant little 18-year-old, and I knew I worked hard, and I'm not a very cocky and arrogant person, but it's kind of what I had developed because of what I'd been through. I was this very, like, hard-surfaced person. And it kind of came crashing down because I lost. And not only did I lose, I got finished, and that's the only time I've ever been finished. And it was definitely an eye-opener for me because it kind of made me realize that, like, you can't just ignore all your problems. I didn't lose that fight because of physical reasons. I lost that fight because mentally I was stuck. Mentally I hadn't evolved. Mentally I wasn't ready to have a challenge. I think the worst fight mentally that I had was against Aaron Blanchfield. I don't remember that fight. I can't recall that fight. I was like a zombie in that fight. And even if you go back and watch, like, you could just see I'm not in my head. After that fight, my dad actually left the cage first. And it was like a form of punishment because I lost. Everything that I did, he somehow made it about him. For a while, I didn't know how to learn from losses because they weren't my losses. He was making them his losses, if that makes sense. My dad definitely was like trying to live through me. He would come and he would watch all my training sessions, and you know, I could be rolling with someone in jiu-jitsu that's like my same level or even better than me. And if anything bad happened, it was like, I knew I was gonna get like the brunt of it, end of it, you know, at home.
He'd be kind of sitting in a corner in wrestling practice, and it definitely put this weird kind of like stressful blanket over the situation. There was often times where I would kind of turn the corner into the kitchen during the wrestling practice, and there's Kay's corner at that time, like in an argument with Kay's dad, and it's just like, are these guys about to like throw down, like wrestle in the kitchen right now? Like, it was just really awkward situations, very stressful. I mean, for anybody who didn't know what was going on, like, it was just another wrestling practice.
Anytime I lost a fight, it was like the end of the world, and I couldn't even really process it because I was trying to just make sure that I was safe and that I was okay, rather than trying to process like a loss for my professional career.
Kay is one of those people where she won't show you that it did affect her mentally. I think Kay did a really good job at harnessing whatever shitty emotions she was feeling throughout that time, and she just applied it to training. And that ended up leading to like overtraining, and just she was just doing a little bit too much, but I think that was because she was using that as fuel, you know?
All my coaches were always like, you know, you could take a little bit of time off. Like, if you ask any one of my coaches that's ever coached me, I'm always the hardest worker in the room. I was at the gym 24/7. I never took a day off. Like, I was having coaches beg me to take a day off, and I refused to listen. Just because of the pressure I put on myself and also the pressure I was getting from my father.
Being so young, she was almost like too driven for her own good. I mean, she loved the sport to death, but sometimes to a fault, and just would not know when to kind of push the brakes.
Like, you know, I would win a fight and then I would lose a fight because I would take it in short notice, and they'd be like, well, maybe you should take a break, kind of step back, reevaluate. And my thought process was just like, I just want to get back in there. I just want to keep going. I just want to keep going. And I think it was, I was doing what I was doing in my fight career, what I was doing with my life. You know, I'm trying to ignore the problems and I'm trying to just keep going because that's how I survive.
I think to bury your trauma and distract yourself is detrimental, because I believe that trauma kind of stores in your body physically and it starts to affect you that way from the inside out. And I think it's just a matter of time before you implode. It's not a good idea to distract yourself and to not deal with your trauma.
You can also kind of just block out people that might even be trying to help you. Like, everything's all about the fight. I don't care how I feel. I don't care what makes me sad. It's all about the fight, and that's all that matters. And for me, although the sport obviously revolves around fighting, you gotta incorporate life.
I think tunnel vision can be a little detrimental just because you can tend to ignore all your problems when you have tunnel vision, or at least that's how I was. You know, I was only focused on, you know, fighting. I didn't care about my mental health. I didn't care about my physical health. I didn't care about anything. All I wanted to do was be the best in the world at fighting. I think it was very detrimental for my mental health and my physical health in the long run. That Sharon Jacobson fight was really crazy.
Sharon Jacobson slightly to the side there. Hansen's trying to pull her that way, but Jacobson's able to break her down.
That fight and where I was at in my life is kind of tricky. I think I was in a very, like, F it mental state. Like, I was just like, I don't even care anymore. I mean, I lost like 99% of that fight, maybe. So pulling out that win after, like, kind of surviving the whole fight was definitely a very crazy feeling for me.
20 seconds left for Kay.
Oh, she tapped!
Kay Hansen from out of nowhere!
For me, I feel like since fighting was my form of therapy, you know, I took a lot of my anger out when it comes to fighting. So any kind of inner anger I had to save for when I fought. So for me, finishing someone as soon as I could was a way for me to get a personal win for myself. I wanted to be the most successful I could in the shortest amount of time as possible.
She grew up so young in the sport and grew this following, developed this following at such a fast pace. I feel like she wasn't really able to be like an 18, 19 year old girl. It was just train, and live in this weird, stressful shadow. I feel like she was kind of diving into this, almost like a burnout.
Burning out as a fighter, the way I look at it is you can go until you can't, and that's what happened to me. I noticed I started kind of slowing down, at least mentally slowing down, but physically I kept training. I was training 3-4 times a day. I was eating 500 calories maybe a day. You know, I was really going through some mental stuff and I was just shoving it down and I really didn't want to deal with it. I didn't want to think of the repercussions and I didn't want to think about what I had been through. So I kind of just shoved it down and ignored it and acted like it didn't happen.
If that's your only way of dealing with, you know, suppressed emotions or frustration in your personal life, you know, you're not exactly solving the issues that you have going on. You're just kind of hiding them. And you can only do that for so long before things start to explode.
I kind of started developing an eating disorder, or at least acknowledging that I had been developing an eating disorder. I feel like it was something I had kind of ignored and made an excuse for. I actually had to step back and pull out of a fight or two because of that reason.
In Kay's specific case, I think the detrimental aspects happen when we hit the eating disorder. That, I think, stems from her being so hyper-focused on the number on the scale. And I think in Kay's case, MMA was great I think the one thing that it gave her was this horrible, horrible relationship with the scale. When you apply so much stress and so much focus on a number and your career revolves around this number, especially if you're a female, that's huge mental stress.
Body dysmorphia is a very crazy concept. I didn't even understand what it was for a long time until I started being vocal about how I felt about my body. It's definitely something I'm still struggling with, but I've definitely gotten a lot better. I used to let my body dysmorphia and what I see in the mirror dictate what I eat or if I can eat. So I've gotten out of that stage, but I'm still working on looking in the mirror and just always loving myself and being happy with what I see. But being a young woman who has been through a lot of trauma and is still in the process of healing and has struggled with body image and struggled with eating disorders, trying to like grow up and become an adult under the public eye is pretty hard.
I think some of the challenges you face developing in the public eye are just everything you do is gonna be scrutinized. You know, everybody makes mistakes when they're young, and even if it's not a mistake, they're still gonna critique you on everything you do. Either you did something wrong or you could have done something better, or even if you did a good job, you know, you should have did a good job sooner.
Taking a year off from my mental health was extremely hard.
When you're used to doing the same thing day in, day out, and then you stop, you don't know what to do with yourself. It's very hard.
When my body had finally like had its max, and then I wasn't allowed to even train for a few months, like my body just had to like recoup from everything, I kind of found myself going a little crazy just because I had used the gym as such a form of therapy that I didn't know how to function without it.
I feel like fighting and painting are obviously two forms of art. They're just very drastic. I feel like this is more of a form of my like peaceful art, and then training and fighting is more of aggressive art.
She took the time to heal, and she's doing it for the right reasons, because she wants to, because this is her decision.
I actually started going to therapy in 2020.
So around that time, I was kind of struggling with accepting what I had been through in the past.
I kind of just had to sit with all this like thoughts and all these like this hatred and anger and kind of just deal with it, when in reality I had just shoved it down before. I had never dealt with it because training and fighting was always there to just fix it for me, I guess.
I kind of found myself like starting to open up and starting to bloom and actually like be able to talk about it and be able to heal from it, and it was really empowering for me, being able to like move on and continue to like grow as a person.
Now that she's a lot more comfortable with not just who she is, but with her emotions and everything, she's not afraid to, you know, tell me when she's having a tough time or tell me when she needs a little extra help, which, you know, everybody should be able to do.
Just a reset, I feel like, was really good for her. She's happier. She has way more clarity. You could just see the way she carries herself. It just seems a little bit more clear in the direction that she wants to go. Kay knows how beneficial this break has been for her, for sure. She knows.
So when I got the courage to step out of the situation with my father, it was the scariest decision of my life, for sure. I didn't know what the repercussions were. I didn't know a life without that control on me. You know, I didn't know who I was because I had fit a mold and I was forced to be someone I wasn't for so long. I reached out to my mom and I moved back with her right away. Our relationship rekindled really fast, and you know, in the process of me learning who I was, she was also kind of doing the same. So she had her own healing to do, along with me having my own healing to do. So doing that together has been kind of cool. And we have a really strong relationship now, and I do with my sister, so I'm very happy.
How do I show Kay my support? I would say more than anything, she's one of my best friends, and just being honored that she comes to me to share everything, or just being there to listen, and more importantly, just support everything that she decides to do in life.
I feel like being in my head is always exhausting. I've only known chaos like for most of my life, so I feel like when I'm at a peaceful moment in my life, something's not right. when you're so used to like trauma and negativity, and like every day is a fight. Like every day you open your eyes and you know, like today's gonna be tough. Like it's gonna, and I'm not talking about like, oh, it's gonna be a long day. Like I'm gonna work hard. I'm gonna, no, like I am surviving today. I feel like when that's all you've known, that's what you get used to, you know? So I got myself out of that situation and I learned who I was. I met the love of my life. I have amazing friendships. Like I'm working through my personal struggles, but I'm also at peace now. I've made a lot of progress and I'm excited.
What Kay has overcome, that's a lot. I can say for Kay, perfect role model of don't let what's happened to you in your past define who you are or stop you from what you want to do in life. Using her platform to really share what's happened to her and just to take that step forward and say, this isn't who I'm gonna be or this isn't who I am. And I want to use my platform to help anyone that I can that may be in these situations.
I think one of the most amazing things that MMA has given me is a platform. You know, as a fighter, it's cool to have that following and that fan base and that support. But at the same time, I have been through something that a lot of people go through. And to be able to have this platform and talk about my struggles and be vulnerable is super important, because if someone I looked up to had told me what they had went through and it was something similar, maybe I would have got out of that situation sooner. Maybe I wouldn't have been as scared.
I think it's important to talk about your struggles, especially when you have a lot of eyes on you, to help other little girls that might need help out there that aren't strong enough to kind of speak up for themselves. Maybe give them a little strength.
You know, putting it all out there is important for me. I think the biggest thing is I need people to hear it, because it is such a common thing that is so untalked about. People shouldn't have to go through things like this in silence.
I think MMA needs K, to be honest. I think young females out there look up to somebody like K, who speak out on things that she's talking about. And she is a role model now. You know, I think she can really, really set the standard high and show people that you can go through something as dark and as stressful as this and come out on top.
I'm just starting to become who I am. And to me, that's the biggest win I could get. You know, learning who I am and learning how to deal with this trauma and not letting it define me. And I'm in a happy life. I really couldn't ask for more right now. The Kay Hansen today is healing. She is learning how to love and accept herself. And in that same process, I am trying to convey what I've been through to help other people. And I love fighting. It's what I love to do. It's my passion. And I'm gonna continue to climb in the sport. I'm still young. I have a long way to go. And I'm gonna continue to be vocal about what I've been through and how to get through it, and just kind of try to be a voice if I could.